All right. Welcome to the Deadpool Home Entertainment Commentary.
Has a nice ring to it.
Thank you. This is Ryan Reynolds. I'm here with Rhett Reese and Paul Wernick.
Hello.
The screenwriters of the Deadpool Cinematic Festival. Just to set the tone, that we're at my house. We're in the basement of my house.
Where we've been for the last 14 months, you've had us locked down here?
Yes, where I've had these guys. So if you hear, we're in my house, if you hear dogs barking or something, or if you hear an elderly door-to-door salesman who sounds like he's tied up with a ball gag and several other things, just carry on. It should also be known that we have a life-size Deadpool in the room with us. The suit that I stole while shooting the film, I brought home with me and is basically sort of presiding over the commentary.
What year was the sexiest man alive, Ryan?
For me or Hugh Jackman?
You.
For me, it was 2010. For Hugh Jackman, 2008.
Both great years.
I saw Hugh the other day, and somebody made a joke about that, and we couldn't tell you who the other guys were, which is sort of...
Oh, sure.
I'm kidding. I've got all the issues right here.
Does anyone want to talk about what inspired the credit scene here?
Yeah.
This was a Philips Carousel advertisement directed by, I think, Adam Berg.
Yep. Adam Berg. Yeah, that's what inspired this. This is 6 years old, basically. This has been in the script forever. This song was the first song we had in the script as well, right?
It was.
Yep. Angel of the Morning by Juice Newton.
Which will introduce Juice to a whole new generation, which we're most excited about.
That's true.
That and this true. Is, of course, 100% CGI. Tim Miller originally wanted to do the vast, vast majority of the movie in a computer entirely. Am I wrong?
He actually wanted to, because he'd never directed a film before, he wanted to do a CGI version of the entire movie first before we set foot on this and practically shot it, which he soon realized was totally ludicrous and impractical. But a great idea. Be nice if we could do that. In our cap here. But also that opening credit sequence was in the movie, then out of the movie, then in the movie, then out of the movie, and thank God it stayed in the end. Because we love it. That's Tim Miller's gum, by the way. That is the director's real gum that was on the ceiling of the
is that right?
Cab. Yes, yes it was.
As actors in that opening credit sequence, did you need to have waivers for that in terms of not having your name on the opening titles?
Dead. No, we didn't. As long as you don't use anyone else's real name. It's fine.
Good enough.
Not the Daffodil Daydream.
The girl.
Ah, yes. Geeta. Mm. She is quite lovely. She would have made me a very agreeable wife. But Geeta's heart...
Should I say where the name Dopinder comes from?
Please, yes.
The name Dopinder is a guy that I went to elementary school with who unfortunately died Dopinder. Being struck by lightning. I'm not making that up.
Cab today.
Yeah, sir, you called for it, remember?
No. My slender brown friend.
And he was a buddy of mine, and I sort of pay homage to him by using his name here in the movie. He's now immortalized by Karan Soni, who plays our Dopinder.
Karan, actually, my daughter found Karan.
Sir, what does Miss Mama June taste like?
Like two.
He was in the AT&T ads, and... And she loves him and thought he was so funny. And she was the one who
really
recommended him to me and then me to the casting director.
Oh,
and then
that.
He came in. Yeah.
God, he was such a find. He was so
great.
Yeah.
Dopinder is talking about the red suit here. Should we talk a little bit about the suit and your reaction to the first time you saw it?
Yeah, that's oh, God. The suit was... made me weep the first time I saw it. In fact, it was...
And subsequently made you weep every time you had to put it on.
That's true. At the beginning of the film, it took about 40 minutes to put it on. And by the end, I had that down to 10. But it is a work of art, that suit. It truly is. Russ Schenkel at Film Illusions created it. They won't disappoint. I think it's the most faithful comic book to screen adaptation of a super suit ever.
Absolutely. I love it. Yeah. It's just awesome.
Yeah.
How many suits were there, Ryan?
There were 9 suits. We destroyed 7 of them shooting the film. And one of the 2 remaining suits I left with at the end of the filming, that's the one that is presiding over our commentary right now. I just walked off set with it and told them to go fuck themselves because I waited 10 years to do the movie. And
broke a few laws.
If they want to take the suit back, they can come try and take it from me. I was in very good shape when I shot the Deadpool movie, and I felt confident that I could take out a 107-pound studio executive.
And contrary to what you might think, you could see out of it pretty well, and we could also hear you talking without it seeming too muffled.
I do feel like we had some dumb luck with the suit there. We really got lucky. You can hear Deadpool very well, and I could see very well. Yeah. We had two different sets of eyes. We had the stunt eyes for the suit, which the black part was sort of a mesh. I could see through it. And then for close-ups, I used an opaque eye mask. So that's an opaque one. You can't see just the white part is like the only piece I could see through. So.
And the eyes pop out, right?
Yeah, they're magnetic. They actually clip on with magnets. And
if you're wondering why Deadpool seems so expressive in the suit, part of that is Ryan's genius physicality in acting him within the suit. But it's also the fact that they did some facial motion capture, and they actually used CG to animate the face in specific scenes so that Deadpool can make expressions, like his eyes open right there, for instance, just a little bit. That's actually done in a computer because the suit itself is not that expressive.
Ryan's Australian accent.
Do you like it?
Absolute favorite.
Like to have a good time with my Aussie accent. Just get right in there and do a little Hugh Jackman.
This was originally conceived in a computer as test footage. We did.
This is part of the infamous test footage
That leaked online. We did it, I think, 2011? We did the test for Fox.
Yep.
Yeah. Tim Miller was, I believe he got what, $300,000? Something like that?
Something.
$275,000 yep. To prove to the studio that he could handle the movie. And he did this wonderful test. And it was so wonderful, but the public never saw it. So we started all hatching a plot when we were having difficulties getting the movie green lit. We started hatching a plot to leak the footage.
Are you in your
And when I say hatching a plot, none of us was technologically savvy enough to actually leak it. So we kept trying to, each of us was trying to convince the others to do it for him.
I think that's what's happened. That's the story we're telling each other, but I think one of us, I believe that one
Ryan
of us
Reynolds.
Did.
Ryan Reynolds.
One of us leaked that footage. And
his name rhymes with Brian Reynolds.
It's kind of like a game of Clue. There are only about 6 or 7 suspects, so you know somebody was in the dining room with the candlestick.
Absolutely. And that's
Which probably is worth talking about, kind of the evolution of the long process of getting this movie made, because again, we're talking now 2011, which was 5 years ago.
Yeah.
And the movie, Ryan, has been in development. What? You were first brought the comics, what, in
2004. I've been involved with Deadpool or attached to some aspect of Deadpool development for 11 years before actually making the movie. So.
And it came to you when you were doing Blade,
it
right?
It came to me when I was doing Blade Trinity. Say what you will about that movie, but I it brought me great things. It was a lot of fun. I got to sort of improvise a lot and goof around. And looking back at it, you know, I look back at it and I think, wow, I was kind of in a weird way playing Wade Wilson in that movie, and I didn't know it. Someone else did though. That's who sent me the comic book, the stack of comics. I was sent them, and a guy I knew said, you know, you're Deadpool. I said, who's Deadpool? He said, you should read these comics. If they ever make a Deadpool movie, you're the guy. And I read him and I fell in love with it. And that was in 2004 when that panel came out in the Deadpool comic that said, you know, asking Deadpool what he looks like. And he said, I'm a cross between Ryan Reynolds and a Sharpay. That was sort of kismet, I thought. So.
And then it moved over to Fox. Yeah. Correct? Because it was at New Line, was it not?
I think it was at New Line was where it was at initially. Avi Arad had it, actually. It was not, I don't know if it was actually had a studio home. Avi Arad owned Marvel at the time, and a little startup called Marvel that seemed to do all right. And then eventually it was at Fox, so with all the other X-Men properties. So, yeah.
And we wrote the script in 2009.
Yep.
And a draft of the script in every calendar year since.
right.
Truly.
Yeah.
2009.
But the script is largely, the storylines have largely stayed the same.
Interestingly, if you go back and read our first draft of the script and then you watch the movie, it's not that different.
It's just more expensive.
A lot more expensive.
Yeah, the old version was too expensive.
At one point, we had a PG-13 version. Fox commissioned us to write a PG-13 version.
It was six pages long.
The character of Angel Dust, played by Gina Carano, was actually three different characters. It was Garrison Kane, Wire, and Sluggo, if you remember that. And then for budget reasons, we did away with two and changed the third to Angel Dust.
Yeah.
We ended up adding Negasonic Teenage Warhead much later.
True.
She was not in the original draft. But Colossus was always there.
This entire sequence is shot on a viaduct in Vancouver, British Columbia, where I grew up. This is my hometown. And I became public enemy number one because we cocked up the traffic in Vancouver for 2.5 weeks while we took over this bridge. Somehow I got thrown under the bus with that. All the media in Vancouver was, blaming me for the issues, which I guess to some degree it is my fault.
Kind of your fault.
So I do apologize to the citizens of Vancouver, British Columbia.
We shot the entire movie in Vancouver.
Yeah, it was great. Good city to shoot in. Great crews.
I think we feel that whenever you're writing an action scene, you want to stack the odds against your hero.
That guy right there who I just shot in the head, he was my double in Blade. He was my stunt double.
Oh, is that right?
That was my main stunt double in Blade.
Wow.
Yeah. Yeah.
But yeah, we always like to stack the odds against the hero, and we did it in this scene by reducing Deadpool's ammunition supply to only 12 bullets, and we just put him in a predicament. How do you use 12 bullets to kill a bunch of guys?
Mm-hmm. It's the only sequence Deadpool shoots a gun. Is that correct?
Pretty much. Yeah.
Otherwise, it's katanas.
Well, one other right at the very end of the film.
Oh,
one
yes.
One bullet.
One bullet.
But
spoiler alert.
We do love the katanas. I got shot in the asshole there, which right up until about a week before shooting that sequence, it was in the face. And then we changed it. We just
Ryan
thought
had
asshole,
the idea
asshole
of getting
would be a lot
shot
funnier.
The ass was so funny, and it gets a huge laugh.
I just always trying to find some way to work in right up Main Street, which is... oh, yeah.
Oh. I'm touching myself.
Today. He shoots one gun there, and
we have both barrels
both are smoking. So
because we're complete ass wipes.
Where you at, Francis?
Oh yeah, that's Glenn. He's about to get it. He's about to get what he deserves.
You do training with the katanas, Ryan. Beforehand, I can't remember. I know you did it going into the Wolverine movie. Did you do it on this one?
I did a lot of it on Wolverine, and then I did, there's only so much you can do with katanas, and this is one of them. It's just spinning them around like that. But I like doing it. I like the katana stuff.
And you have some katanas in the house from Wolverine, don't you? Didn't you take the katanas?
I did take the katanas.
So this is steal everything. Yeah, you're a little bit of a kleptomaniac.
In a fitting piece of destiny, those were stolen from me.
Were they?
I moved, and somebody stole the Wolverine.
That's a huge
katanas.
Bummer.
Yeah. But right next to you are actually a pair of katanas that are stolen from there. On the Deadpool right there.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Look, would it help if I...
Oh, those jeans.
Great.
That was our ass-to-ass transition.
Yep.
A nod to Requiem for a Dream.
A nod to Fellini.
I did.
It always bugged me that I flushed the toilet after telling him I just took a shit in his kitty litter box.
Yeah.
The fuck you doing on my trip?
Is it burnt crust?
That is B. Arthur on the shirt.
The was yep. that poker game. I told Howie. I told him.
That cost $10,000. I don't mind saying.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Oh, is that right?
Who did we have to license that from? Is that B. Arthur's Estate or is that exactly Golden Girls?
It. It was the B. Arthur's Estate. It was a donation to one of her charities, which I think was wonderful and totally worthwhile doing. But as a producer, I had to approve a $10,000, which was just stupid at the time because we were so desperate to keep every penny on the screen and our movie did not have a big budget at all. But you can't have a Deadpool movie without B. Arthur appearing. So I felt like it was worth it.
Oh, for sure.
Yeah.
Not a chandelier. Yes, I'm keeping your wallet. You did kind of give it to me.
Okay, just look, man, can I have my Sam's
car? I will shoot your fucking...
Those sunglasses that Gavin's wearing right there end up on your face in the next scene, and I think very few people will make that connection.
Anybody, I know, and I always cringe as I'm coming down the stairs wearing them in the next scene because I worry that people think I just made a fashion choice by selecting those glasses. Orlowski?
The pizza box is... Feige's famous.
Kevin Feige.
Kevin Feige, a little Easter egg to the head of Marvel, the genius behind Marvel.
That's true.
But it does bear mentioning, this is not a Marvel Studio movie. This is a Fox movie, and a lot of people make that mistake or make that assumption that this is...
I'm always shocked how many people in the media make that mistake, too. You get a lot of that, too.
Yes, sir.
So
we're done.
Wait. And the media is never wrong. That guy was great. That guy was fantastic.
Leave a book in her general direction again, and you will learn in the worst of ways that I have some hard spots, too. That came out wrong.
He had no idea I was going to kiss him here, and he reacted perfectly. I was very happy. Oh, there you go.
This we shot. This was the final scene we shot of the
whole
movie.
Film, yeah.
It was.
And we said it would never see the light of day.
And here we are.
Mostly because of those glasses that nobody realizes are from.
I love your expression when you look at them, though. Here, as you take them off.
Thank God we found that take because, there you go. They're really horrible. Kids, how it's done. That's why we do it, but mostly the money. Rollerblades, for whatever reason, have always made me laugh.
Always, that was a Ryan ad lib. Ryan is just a genius ad libber. A genius improviser.
No. That I hate.
We have a lot of fun. We all had a lot of fun writing alts, though. Like that was our favorite pastime on the set.
Yeah.
I'm just a bad guy who gets paid to fuck up worse guys. Welcome to Sister Margaret's. It's like a job fair for mercenaries.
Sister Margaret's. We shot. That was. What bar in Vancouver was that, Ryan? That was
The Cobalt Bar, the Cobalt in Vancouver. A bar when I was a kid you would never go within 3,000 feet of, and now is just like hipster central.
Is it? Because it felt like you still wouldn't go within 3,000 feet.
Yeah, it has its night. It has Civic Night where it's sort of hipster central. But yeah, otherwise it's generally kind
of... Make sure that gets back to Ms.
I wouldn't go within 3,000 feet of hipster central, to be honest.
So. Well, that's true, yeah.
For a merc, you're pretty warm-blooded. Bet you let the kid off easy, too.
T.J. Miller, really? Force of nature.
Love T.J. Miller.
Light stalking. I was way worse than him when I was his age. I was traveling to exotic places, Baghdad.
T.J. Miller's one of those guys that can... He can't not improvise. Like, you can't... It's like a fish in water. He just has to fuck around, and it's great. And at least this is the kind of film where we leave a lot of room to do that, so...
Bailey's and whipped cream. I give you a blowjob. Why don't you make me make that?
Kelly. Take that over to Buck, please, and tell him it's from Booth. A little foreplay.
Remind me what good will come of this.
I don't take the shits. I just disturb them.
Hold
up. Cheers. To your health.
Fuck you.
Come here.
That's a new stool. Arrest.
Now, originally you had bet on Alex Trebek in the Deadpool, right? That was who you decided?
I bet on Alex Trebek. I said it because Alejandra's favorite color is cocaine.
Nobody wins today. Nice try, Wade.
You got me. I picked Booth in the Deadpool. Who'd you pick?
Yeah, wait about that.
No. You did not bet on me to die.
You bet on me to die.
Is anybody dead on the Deadpool? now? That would be awful.
That would be awful.
That's not the case.
No, I don't think it is the case. But who's up on that board? It's
oh, you got everybody.
There's some
up
great
there.
Ones.
Bill Cosby. You got Tim Miller. You got me.
Yeah.
You got Ryan Reynolds.
Ryan Reynolds.
There's a shit ton of
Justin Bieber's up there.
You know, Justin Bieber was initially one of the names I had on the Deadpool, or one of the guys I had picked for the Deadpool.
Tight.
Vanessa.
Wait.
When we were trying to get the movie made, we were doing everything and anything, and actually there was a computer program that you could, it was like an animated computer program where the voice was a computer-generated voice, and you could punch in dialogue, and the computer would spit out the voice matched to the animated characters.
I love that. And is, we that, made is that available one, somewhere?
You know, I tried to pull it back up, and I couldn't. They had gotten rid of it. It didn't exist anymore.
We made one for this particular scene.
I always love this dialogue. This is just you guys being geniuses. I love this dialogue here between the both of us.
I was molested.
Me too.
Morena was such a sport. Just loved. She loves working blue. She's
your bedroom.
She has a wonderful potty mouth.
You had a dishwasher. I didn't even know sleep. It was pretty much 24/7 ball gags, brownie mix, and clown porn.
Boy, I'm just afraid of that word clown porn. That just sounds terrifying.
Clown porn?
Yeah.
You'd be shocked. It's actually not bad.
Hey, what can I get for...
Did they shave a little notch into your eyebrow, Ryan?
You only realized that just now?
I just now realized
that. Of course. There's scars all over my head and my face. And we wanted to give Wade a kind of look of... as though he had a sort of a history of violence. And so there's scars all over. You can see the side of my head. There's one that runs through my eyebrow. And that's all just the great Bill Corso, who's just a genius makeup artist, who also did our scarring effect on Deadpool's face. He did Foxcatcher and a few other movies that are just, you know, Lemony Snicket's incredible makeup work.
Tireless, too. You know, on set at, you know, crack of dawn all the way through.
Yeah, just great attitude. Great work. Yeah.
The skee ball scene was not in the original script, and it was added to give a little bit more of a sense of connection and a romantic development between these two characters so that their relationship wasn't too based just on sex. And I think it captures Wade's kind of immature, childish spirit. I think one of the most important characteristics of Deadpool is his childish nature.
Yeah, he really sort of represents a huge part of the population that are adult geeks, you know, and I love that. I love that about him. He worships the Voltron ring. And
my children were in this scene and ended up on the cutting room floor, actually.
Where they belong.
Where they belong.
Where they belong.
If their performances
no
had been better.
No nepotism on this film, I'm sorry.
Voltron, Red, talk about the Voltron thing, because that was a little bit of a late ad.
Well, I think, again, it was just getting at that nerd. Okay, we got to stop talking about Voltron and start talking about this, because this was probably the toughest particular sequence in the movie.
How is it that we spent more time on this fucking sequence?
I know.
Than any other sequence in the film, I think.
It was just so difficult to choreograph and design jokes around and
get the right tone.
Yeah. International Women's Day coming up. That's one of our favorites.
Which is what, March 8th, right?
March 8th, International Women's Day. Yep. Also, my brother's birthday and Alanis Morissette Day.
Mm. All March 8th?
I know.
Is that right?
I know my...
you know your March 8th.
We know our holidays now after this fucking movie. We actually had an alt here, which was a happy Alanis Morissette Day, but we didn't use it.
We had to line up all the holidays so that they occurred in the correct chronological order around the year, which was difficult.
We could have just shot a scene where two people fuck for 5 minutes. That might have been easier.
Surely easier.
But we do love our Deadpool audience. So.
Your left leg is Thanksgiving and your right leg is Christmas. Kind of busy between the holidays.
Angus Strathy was our costume designer who found all these horrific sweaters. That looks good on you. This is just the worst one I chose. You can imagine what was available.
I've been thinking.
Really?
About why we're so good together.
Why is that?
Well, your crazy matches my crazy. Big time. And we're like two jigsaw pieces, you know, the weird curvy edges.
You put them together and you can see the picture on top. Wait. There's something I've been meaning to ask you. But only because you haven't gotten around to asking me. Will you, stick it
marry
in
me?
My brother actually proposed to his wife with a ring pop.
Really?
Yeah.
Was that true?
Was it yes. Hiding up his asshole as well?
I will have to ask him.
Please do. I would love to. You know.
I love you, Wade Wilson.
You're supposed to. So that's
it. Yes!
There we go.
Yes!
There we go.
I feel just like a little girl. What if I just held on and never let go?
Just ride a bitch's back like Yoda and Luke.
Oh, Star Wars jokes.
Empire.
Jesus Christ, it's like
you know, interestingly, this movie is many things, and it really is. The beating heart of it is the love story between these two characters.
Yeah, we've kind of made a joke about that in the marketing, but it really actually is sort of true. It does kind of anchor everything. You know, it's what fuels the revenge story in the film. And
it is a fucked up romantic comedy.
Yeah,
and again, it's many things, but that is one thing. It is.
Yeah. God bless it, though.
Oh, look at that. Look at that. That's years of hard work right there in the gym.
And a lot of salmon.
There's a lot of salmon I ate for this movie.
It's whole rivers just, full of salmon are just...
I single-handedly depleted the world's salmon supply.
I sense clowns.
This was the first scene we shot of the movie.
Oh my God, you're right. I always think it's Blind Al, but this was day minus one. This was an off the record day.
Yep.
We shot this in pre-production just because we had basically $50 to make a $500 movie, let's say. And so we had to do a lot of cheating and fudging. And one of them was shooting this day in advance. So it was kind of off the books.
It was a 48 day shoot, which is for a movie like this.
It's insane.
Tiny.
It's like a little independent film shooting schedule. So, yeah.
Most movies of this scope and scale, really, that's second unit, you know, days. Or
I'll invoke Green Lantern for a second time. Green Lantern, just to give you perspective, was an 89-day shoot. And this was 48.
So we were lean and mean.
Yeah.
And, you know, really the mother of invention, I feel like. It forced us to look at things in a different way and attack things.
Necessity is truly invention's mama. And it made us focus on character so much more than anything else. But we still got to do some fun stuff like that.
Yeah. I mean, among the scenes we had to cut for budget, we did have a motorcycle chase here where Deadpool was chasing Ajax on a motorcycle.
Oh, I missed that sequence, though. That would have been fun.
I love that, too. Yeah.
Wade W. Wilson out of Regina, Saskatchewan.
Regina, Saskatchewan. That joke probably only makes Canadians laugh, but it makes me laugh. Oh, and that is why Regina rhymes with fun.
Which, Ryan, tell us the story. You were a child?
I was not. I wish I was a child. I was about 25 years old, and I was in Regina, Saskatchewan, and I got in a lot of trouble because I messed with a sign and changed it. I just actually put another sign over it, so I didn't actually vandalize public property, but I put another sign over it that said, "Welcome to Regina," which rhymes with fun. And I got in a lot of trouble for that. But, you know, something good came out of it. It's now in the Deadpool movie.
How about now?
That's all computer generated right there. Ryan obviously wasn't in the scarred makeup.
I sure wasn't.
Under the mask. When he was in the mask, that was...
Yeah, like I got bit by a radioactive Shar-Pei.
But something you just said, where you said it makes me laugh, I think that's an important point because so much of the comedy in this movie we had to rely on our guts and say, well, does it make us laugh? I mean, and we took that approach. If it's making us laugh, perhaps it will make others laugh. And I think that held us in pretty good stead.
I do too. We had some, you know, this is another one that just made us laugh and people seem to like it. It's TJ Miller's favorite joke.
I think we can all agree that shit just went sideways in the most colossal way. Well, maybe not the most.
Well, there's our Wolverine X-Men Origins reference. I think maybe we only make two or three references to it in the movie, but that's one of them.
You know what people don't get is the one where I'm going to sew your pretty little mouth shut.
And I say, I wouldn't do that. You know?
People don't click in on that as much, realize, but it's on second viewing maybe. Or third viewing. Peters.
Sounds like you do.
Yeah, I do think the movie will have a lot of second and third viewing surprises for people who miss things the first time.
There's lots of jokes.
Pretty rich in detail.
I ran into Bernadette Peters, which is just a weird thing to say, in New York City maybe 4 months ago. And she mentioned this scene because she had to give her permission for us to use her name. And she was very flattered and very sweet about it.
And in our start gifts, there was a signed Bernadette Peters framed 8x10 of her. Which I actually think Simon Kinberg forged her signature.
I believe he did. I found out for a fact that indeed Simon Kinberg forged Bernadette Peters' signature, which is probably illegal.
I think so. Bernadette, if you're out there, we would Simon love Kinberg. An original sign.
His number picture. Is 310-874.
No one is boomboxing shit, okay? We can fight this.
Brett, talk about some of the obscure references, the Yakov Smirnoff and, you know.
Well, I think we always felt that not every reference had to make sense for every audience member. So we freed ourselves and allowed ourselves occasionally to make references that we thought only a few people would get. I mean, when you're talking about Ronnie Millsap,
God.
A movie that's intended for 17 to 34-year-olds, you're going to go over some heads. But we were committed to the idea that Deadpool has a deep understanding and memory for pop culture, and that we just had to honor that.
Well, we all kind of do. All three of us together we love pop culture. I'm not saying that we always understand, but we love it. And we make a cocoon joke in the movie. I mean, that was fun. I love that.
Yeah, usually they say, you know, pop culture, has to be a timeless reference so that it doesn't date the movie. But again, as Rhett was saying, the beauty of Deadpool is you can make those obscure references for comedy and it still works and almost even, you know, enhances the movie in such a way that.
Totally, Paul, was that your joke, the Chechnya? Isn't that where you go to get cancer?
Yeah, we added that in an ADR, actually.
It used to be Chechnya. I hear that's nice this time of never.
Yeah.
Which is also fun. And we were setting up a sequence in the movie that will likely be in the deleted scenes where Wade goes on a world tour to get his cancer cured.
Oh, God. Yeah, that was
good stuff. And ultimately ends up in Guadalajara, Mexico, and meets a quack doctor who's taking advantage of cancer victims and ends up killing him and feels guilty about it. There's a whole sequence we ended up taking out of the movie after much long discussion. And hopefully you'll find it in the deleted scenes. Yeah. And if not, SOL.
This is Jed Reese, local Vancouver actor, guy I've known for maybe 20 years. Great actor, fun, game for anything.
Galaxy Quest.
Yeah, he played the good alien in Galaxy Quest.
He had fun on Deadpool. He's very sad that we killed him because he was hoping to be in the sequel.
And interestingly, Agent Smith, obviously a nod to
The Matrix.
The Matrix. Yeah. Although some people think his name is Agent Smith.
Yeah, and that was an improv of yours, wasn't it, Ryan? The Agent Smith thing. It made me laugh in the moment.
I think that was actually your guys writing. I think so. I made sort of the horrible pedophile jokes. I think about the. At the end of the scene, but
so funny.
Agent Smith was you guys, which I love. Yeah.
Have you seen the GIF I'm not sure that's going around that it's you doing the shake weight back and forth.
Yeah.
It's really funny.
I have. I don't know. I'm not sure how I feel about it. Actually,
I love it. Made me laugh.
Can you imagine? We're gonna have to start tailoring performances to whether or not they'll be turned into GIFs.
Yeah.
Is it GIF or GIF?
I think it's fuck. GIF, but...
I thought
but,
we're pop culture
I know.
Savvy in some way, but no. I think it's GIF. Yeah.
What do you say?
I hate seeing that business card with the 555 on it. That always drives takes it me out of the movie. It
just drove us all crazy.
It's actually Ryan's cell phone number, isn't
yes.
it?
Yes. Give call it a shout. It, please. Give it a try.
Call it. Give it a try. It doesn't even need an area code. You just no. do the seven numbers.
555. I can't believe we have that in there and we don't even make a joke about it. Hey, sorry. This is a joke from Rhett and Paul, which is one of my favorites.
I think we wrote the front half of it, and then this was your improvised line about him being a bad parent, which made us laugh so hard.
Oh, God. Yeah.
He made three of those movies. At some point, you have to wonder if he's just a bad parent.
I would like that, you know, Deadpool's, or Wade, Luke Wilson in that moment, he's got obviously got his mind on something else, and he's in this tragic moment, but he's still sort of... keeps up appearances, and it sort of shows how his mind works. He's still making these jokes, these random jokes. He's even phoning them in, but it's still a lot of fun.
Yeah, it's really, you know, Wade Wilson, Deadpool, is such a complex character that really, you know, you look at his life and there's so much tragedy in it. And he hides behind that tragedy. You know, the comedy, you know, is what kind of masks the tragedy of his life. And I feel that it really makes him relatable, you know, in a way that, you know, he's struggling with things that everybody in real life struggles with and deals with it in his own particular way.
Mm-hmm.
Pro. They pull down a gaggle of ass. Local dry cleaning discounts, lucrative film deals.
Here comes fourth wall, another fourth wall moment. Ryan, talk about Deadpool and fourth wall and the comics. And
well, you can't have Deadpool without him breaking the fourth wall. That was the first thing that we all sort of agreed upon years and years ago. And we tried to do as much of it as made sense in the filming. And actually, by the end of the movie, we actually went back to camera and shot a few extra ones because we just felt like we didn't have enough. So and I love breaking the fourth wall.
It's really a signature of Deadpool and was in the comics from the very start.
Negasonic teenage. What the shit? That's the coolest.
And not only fourth wall in that he's addressing the camera, but he's also very aware that he's in a movie and that he's a superhero, right, Rhett?
Yeah. Yeah. Well, or not a superhero.
Yeah.
Yeah.
As the case may be, but yes.
Can we go?
Look, I'm a teenage girl.
Negasonic teenage warhead.
I'm all about long sullen silences.
Rhett, talk about how we stumbled onto her and
well, Tim, our director, wanted some extra superheroes in the movie, particularly on the X-Men side. And Colossus was already in there, but we thought a trainee might be fun. And Tim gave us this list of potential minor characters to use, and Negasonic was on the list. And we just fell in love with the name. We said, who cares what she's like necessarily, but that name is just priceless. So we built the character around the name.
That guy was already up there when I got here.
A Ryan Reynolds ad lib genius right there.
Well.
And NTW, her powers, she did not, in the comics, she doesn't have the explosive power that she has in our movie. And for us to have added that power to her resume, we had to ask Marvel for permission.
Until then, I'm going to do what I came here to do. Either that... or slap the bitch out of you.
Wait.
Hey.
Zip it, Sinead.
Hey, douche pool.
And I hope you're watching.
Quite unfortunate.
Colossus is a tremendous piece of CG. I mean, he's
yeah,
just so impressive, and I think much better than he has been in earlier incarnations.
Well, he's certainly a faithful adaptation of Deadpool.
Very much.
Colossus now.
And really, it's an actor in a mocap suit, Andre.
Yeah, very hard to pronounce last name, French-Canadian name, Tricadeau, yeah. Great actor.
So a lot of different pieces went in to make Colossus. Obviously, you have Andre, who was on set in who was what, about a 6'5" giant who wore platform boots to make himself about 6'8". And
we had him. He was about 7'5".
Is that right?
The height that we ended up, keeping Colossus.
Well, he had that little tennis ball on top of his head. Too.
Yeah, to get him even higher.
Like a Teletubby.
Yeah.
And then there was a facial capture of another actor. I don't know. Do you know who that actor was?
I'm not sure, but then there was a third gentleman
who does the voice.
Yeah.
You ever see 127 Hours? Spoiler alert.
That was one of my favorite jokes, which was the McAvoy or Stewart joke, which really kind of sums up Deadpool in a very easy to digest way. Just the understanding of knowing he's in a movie, the pop culture references, and the timelines.
When it came time to create Colossus's face, there was a internal push to have his face be captured by Rob Gronkowski, to have them use Rob Gronkowski's face as the face for Colossus. It didn't work out, but it made us laugh.
Breathtakingly fucked. You can generally
the movie's told in a non-linear format. It bounces in and out of time and space.
This.
We did that for a number of different reasons, one of which the big action sequence, which is on the freeway, extends over the course of the almost first half of the movie. And we did that because budget was such that we wanted to start the movie with an action sequence and have action, sprinkled throughout the first act, but couldn't afford to do, three different action sequences. So we structured the film such that we started and then bounced in and out of time and space.
This place seems sanitary.
This was shot in an old World War I munitions factory. So I think we all contracted some horrifying diseases by being there.
It's gone now. This was the last thing that building was ever used for. It was bulldozed shortly after filming.
Easy.
Probably turned into condos, no doubt.
A little strong for a lady? I'm calling Wang.
Gina, so fun, so tough, but so gentle for a fighter. She's a fighter and she's a... Never felt that comfortable manhandling me. I had to keep asking her to be rougher.
We have another tool gun.
And Ed, who is just an absolute true warrior, the most enthusiastic person I think I've ever met. I've said that if he were on the deck of the Titanic and it were sinking, he would be the only one standing there doing a jig. Like, he just doesn't have a negative bone in his body.
Unflappable. So he's kind of the perfect co-star,
This may cause you some discomfort.
Just shows up ready to work every day. Good attitude.
Happy to be there.
Yeah. And great, just really filled Ajax out exactly how we'd hoped.
If you think superhuman powers are acquired painlessly,
well, he wasn't written British, but when we found Ed, when Tim cast Ed,
but we need to subject you to.
We thought, it really adds to the character to keep his British accent. He's obviously British, so
makes him angry, right? I'm about to hurt you, Wade.
I was a patient here once myself, The treatment affects everyone differently. It made Angel inhumanly strong.
When you're acting...
In my case...
In pain, do you rely on sense memory, or how do you trick yourself into feeling pain that's not there?
That's a good question. I've certainly had enough accidents in my life to know what it feels like to kind of seize up like that, but mostly you're just rigid when you're in pain, and that's kind of what you're. I don't know. I'm not really an actor, to be honest. I actually have a man's hand up my ass who's puppeting my body throughout the course. It's my agent, actually.
Well, I would imagine acting in a lot of ways is an exercise in deluding yourself, right? I mean, because you're ultimately deluding an audience, but at some level you have to delude yourself to feel the things that you're supposed
you
to
just
be
believe it, and it sounds easy enough, but it's not that easy, but you just believe it. You just make yourself believe.
We'll see about that. I suppose we will. He's all yours.
Oh, come on. You gonna leave me all alone here with less angry Rosie O'Donnell?
There's a string of about 15 to 20 Ryan ad-libs there. Of-
Well, really, God bless Gina Carano for being such a sport. I must have insulted her with every insult you could possibly.
Jose Canseco.
China, Kevin Sorbo.
Yeah, the Chris Angel.
Chris Angel, Mind Freak.
Busta Rhymes.
Busta Rhymes.
I don't know if are those going to be on the DVD. I hope so.
I hope so too. I'm trying to remember. Yeah, there's a few more in there.
And that ice bath was what? Warm water with little that plastic ice bath cubes in it?
It was boiling hot. Actually, it was too hot for me to stay in. And then to pretend like you're freezing was just.
And the goo was freezing? Wasn't the goo?
No, the goo was just the slipperiest substance known to man. I couldn't actually walk out of there to the, back to the trailer to get cleaned up. And it doesn't come off. It
and took, the tub was too small, to too, right?
Oh, yeah. It was just it's a fucking nightmare.
NBA's Sacramento Monarchs.
Anything on my bucket list would involve public nudity.
Finally, giving Meredith Baxter.
Bernie. That's Worm. Worm is from the comics.
He is in the yeah, he's in the comics.
I don't think he's ever called Worm in the movie, is he?
Nope.
Cunningham.
Yeah, we call him Cunningham. Yeah.
Which I think is his.
I think it's his
actual name,
name
yeah, the and then his nickname is Worm. Yeah.
I want my whole life to be lit like that Vanessa moment right there.
Oh, God, I know.
Just be walking through a Liz Taylor commercial.
Yeah, just, oh.
White diamonds.
Right. I'm wearing white diamonds right now.
Hey, don't take any shit from him, Cunningham. How tough can he be?
I love this look when he hears the word Francis. I love seeing those eyes go up. Ed's face has.
It's like a snake.
Yeah, it's like it casts shadows almost. It's so cool.
The dish soap.
Ajax from a dish soap. Huge laugh. Probably the, you know, in weird, audiences right? we've yeah. seen it, probably the third biggest laugh of the movie.
Yeah.
And we didn't see it coming at all.
No, I never thought it was.
Really in fact, funny. Ajax, I don't even think it's a dish soap, is it?
It's a, it is a cleaning product. Abrasive, a cleanser cleaning product. Sorry, yeah. I think it's like a counter, like all-purpose counter cleaner or something. We just gave them about 500 grand worth of advertising, by the way. There.
Here's the problem. Round-the-clock torture is that you can't really step it up from there.
To the three people that listen to a DVD commentary.
Yes.
Which will be us three.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
We have dirty kitchens.
Yeah.
We may need.
Yeah.
If this doesn't unlock your mutation, then we'll.
This fucking machine. I feel like I lived in it for 2 weeks, even though it wasn't that long, but. God.
In the script, it was called the Punch Bowl. I don't think it's called the Punch Bowl in this, anymore.
But it really was, I really was completely strapped into it. And it was just always a slightly disconcerting feeling to know that if that building caught on fire, I'd basically be fucked. People would be using me as a doormat, climbing over me just to scramble outside.
Come on now. We would have.
Like wheeled
the old,
me out?
Well, like the old pharaohs, we would have climbed in there with you and burned alive just to honor your sacrifice.
I think the original punch bowl, the first punch bowl that came out was, I think, cost $750,000, I think, to make that prop. I think it was our most expensive prop next to your suit, which was a little bit.
Wait, that punch bowl cost $750,000?
Yes.
No.
Yes, the first one did.
Not this one, though.
Yes.
Wait, really?
Yeah.
I should know that. That's what?
I'm pretty sure that's the case.
Maybe you just made that up.
I don't believe you. That there's no way.
We're getting to the bottom of this.
Yeah. Stand by.
Someone's in trouble.
You're never going home after this. That is a brave face.
And my God, when Ryan acted this scene, the breasts and the fighting for it.
Yeah, well, you could watch everyone at the monitors just.
They were still so
ill at ease just because it just made them feel like they were gasping for breath. It was tough to watch.
It's so brilliantly acted.
Terrible way to go.
Oh my God. So, and this must have been one of the harder scenes just physically for you to do, Ryan, in terms of just what it took your body, you know, the toll it took on your body. Like this was,
well, there's a lot of stuff we cut out, which was really the hardest part of it, I think, but we kept a few pieces in and It was worth it.
Oh, yeah, I mean, I think we ended up trimming down what was originally there because it was so oppressive. It was
it was a little intense. It was...
How did that feel on your skin, Ryan?
What?
Oh, this is VFX.
Computer generated.
I know.
Good Lord.
Did I say this was a love story? No. It's a horror movie.
Yeah. There he is.
Fucking hell. Is that someone else to show I'm coming, King?
What have you done to me?
I've merely raised your stress levels high enough to trigger a mutation.
You sadistic fuck!
I've cured you, Wade.
You know, some comic book fans will be sad to hear that there is a scene that we cut out which actually has Killebrew, Dr. Killebrew, in this sequence. That after unbelievable debate, we took out of the film, but it was with a heavy heart we took it out, but it just had to go. It was
just one more layer in the bad guy plot. You know, that Ajax really worked for Dr. Killebrew, who you didn't know was the mastermind until the very end of the movie.
Mm-hmm.
I think audiences just got a little bit confused about the hierarchy, and it just made sense ultimately to simplify it.
Yeah, and it's just the straight revenge story you don't really want to mess with, and it's between these two guys. It's between Wade Wilson and Ajax, and adding that extra layer was tough. It was tough to digest.
Talk about the makeup, Ryan. How long of a process was it to put you in the face and at times the full body makeup?
Well, the full body one is just a pain in the ass that's unavoidable. But this one's not too bad. When you do arms and face, it's about 5 hours. That's about 5 hours. But when you do full body, which is the sequence that comes up after this, so did head to toe, naked fight scene. Full body, that's about 8 or 9 hours. And then, you know, you do a 15-hour shoot day and you're working 25, 26 hours in a day. So tough days, but you don't complain. You just remind yourself that you're getting to make Deadpool after 10 years of waiting.
So hours to put it on, and what, about 30 seconds to just rip it off yourself, right?
At the end of each day, man, I was counting the seconds to rip it off, and I would do it with my hands, which would totally aggravate our sweet, incredible, genius makeup artist Bill Corso, because he was worried about my skin, because it would, when you rip it off, it's epoxied to your skin, so it's kind of damaging. But I didn't care. I was just dying to get home.
And you spent about a third, I think we broke it down, a third in the costume, a third in the makeup, a third as you know, unscarred Wade Wilson before he became Deadpool.
Yeah, that was the sort of equation we felt would work best for the studio. And it ended up working best for the film, too, which aren't always the same, so.
I like the fact that that you got out by virtue of this match. I think a lot of times as a screenwriter, you're trying to get your protagonist locked in a box and then figure out how to get them out in a way that's not overly obvious. And you know, we planted that match in the mouth of Angel Dust, always with the intent to have it be the device that Wade used to get out of the punch bowl. It's kind of cool.
Yeah, I always loved that too. That was a nice plant payoff, as you call it. These scenes were fun. You know, Ed Skrein is so physically gifted and spent months and months training with fighters and all kinds of stuff. And I think it really shows in the sequence. He's so good physically. He has this kind of simian quality, which is great.
You know how to kill me? I'm the only one who can fix your ugly mug.
Your penis there, that's your actual penis, yes, Ryan?
Of course it is. 100%. My penis looks like pepperoni flatbread.
I can vouch for that.
Yeah. Kind of a terrible way to die, I would imagine.
But a great way to discover your powers.
Yeah.
What's my name?
That fucking room had to be 145 degrees. I mean, it was just intense. So much fire, so much heat trapped in there. Fire marshal kept shutting us down because the interior temperature rose to such a degree that it was a huge fire hazard. So it's a long, slow day.
And this was the 25-hour day, right?
This was the 25-hour shooting day for me. Yeah.
And it's not as though we were shooting in an ex-munitions factory that might explode.
I know. Genius location manager. It's another sort of god-awful.
Yeah, this scene was originally followed by a sequence in which Wade tested out his invulnerability by committing suicide in ridiculous ways. And it made us laugh. He was throwing himself out of subway cars and jumping into polar bear enclosures and doing all kinds of self-destructive things. But ultimately, I think that for the tone, it just made more sense to keep this reasonably serious.
The tone of this movie, it was a real, you know, juggling act in terms of, you know, bouncing in and out of darkness and humor and cancer. If done wrong, it can be a disaster. It can feel, you know, schizophrenic and inconsistent. But I think, you know, we all managed to string together the movie in such a way that the tone really does work. It's a ride, you know, in and out of
mm-hmm.
fun and tragedy and sadness. And
made the edit room a real roller coaster ride, though. There's a lot of different, when you shoot a movie that has a fractured narrative like this, you can really kind of, you can compose the movie in so many different ways and so many different timelines. I mean, at one point we experimented with a linear timeline, which was just a disaster and a nightmare for us because it was never written that way by Rhett and Paul, and it just presented a lot of problems. But
and again, I think that has to do with tone. It's, you know, the origin story of Deadpool is so dark. You know, a character who has cancer, who loses his, you know, scarring and loses his girl. I feel like the nonlinear nature allowed us to bounce in and out of, you know, tones that created not too much darkness and over a, you know, a long period of time, that you could give the audience, you know, breaks of the darkness, you know, amongst the comedy and lightness of him being Deadpool.
Typical summer day in Vancouver, British Columbia.
I'm not making her life as ugly as mine.
Come on, Wade, it can't be that bad.
Oh, bullshit. I'm a monster inside and out. Belong in a fucking circus.
Wait, Vanessa loves you. She doesn't care what you low.
Oh, do you like what you see?
No.
You could have cut together an entire film just of TJ Miller doing alternate jokes here.
Not gently, like it was hate fucking. There was something wrong with the relationship, and that was the only catharsis that they could find.
The only reason we stopped shooting the scene was because TJ eventually had to go to sleep.
We also shot the scene twice.
Yeah. This is the second.
Because we had to alter some key information in the middle of it. So we shot this whole scene and it was working great. And then we had to go back and do it again. And we were afraid, are we going to recapture the magic? But thanks to Ryan and TJ's comic chemistry, it worked out.
Yeah, this is a full 6 months after shooting finished.
I'm going to work through his crew until somebody gives up Francis, force him to fix this, then put a bullet in his skull and fuck the brain hole.
I don't want to see that or think of it.
That is kind of stolen from Dan Aykroyd in Gross Point Blank when he says that he's going to fuck the brain hole of someone. And I always love that.
A big reference point for you, Gross Point Blank. You love that movie.
I do love Gross Point Blank. I'm a little obsessed with it.
Great movie.
Yeah.
Like a testicle with teeth.
You will die alone. If you could die, ideally, for others' sake.
That'll do.
All you need now is a suit and a nickname, like Wade the Wisecracker or scared.
I don't know why dying alone makes me laugh more than any other joke in that.
What? I put all my money on you, and now I just realize I'm never going to win the
Deadpool.
Captain
Deadpool.
No, just Deadpool. Yeah. To you, Mr. Poole. Deadpool. That sounds like a fucking franchise.
Oh, I was always so uncomfortable with that line.
It gets a laugh, though.
Yep. Deadpool.
It gets a laugh.
Yep.
Deadpool. Yeah, originally this montage was, believe it or not, just Deadpool going on random kills while Ajax was waiting to get out of prison. Ajax had gone to prison at the end of the workshop fight, and Deadpool was just biding his time waiting for Ajax to get out of prison. But somebody, I think it might have been Simon, had the bright idea to make this montage into a search for Ajax. So Ajax doesn't go to prison, and Deadpool goes on a month to year long search for his archenemy.
Which is why we had to fucking change that whole bar scene too.
Yeah, and it gave it some propulsive energy. I mean, you're starting to feel like Deadpool's got a goal here, and obviously it's to find Francis.
Yeah. And it's worth mentioning, you know, Simon was really our guardian angel on this movie. You know, he...
Very true.
He came aboard. Fox has immense trust in him. He's the keeper of the X-Universe, and he came aboard, and we were off to the races.
He just really protected the tone and the vibe of Deadpool. And
yes.
He was a huge asset to us. Amazing.
I'm on that board somewhere, a picture of me. I don't think it's in the movie.
Why is Zamboni? Where's
Francis? The Zamboni idea was our first AD. That was his idea to shoot a pill with the Zamboni, and I love it.
Yeah.
Good Canadian joke right there.
This is confusing. Is it sexist to hit you? Is it more sexist to not hit you? I mean, the line gets real blurry. Donde esta
Francesca? In case you were wondering what Donde esta Francesca
Jesus.
Means, where is Francis?
That drives Paul insane.
I'm sorry.
And I'm with him on that one. I have no idea why we subtitled that.
Agent Smith, 555-0199. Ryan Reynolds, number. Those are bags of rice.
Yeah. Rice to see you.
Bye.
That was a joke. We wanted to get in there, but we didn't. Fully loaded.
A little known fact, we spend most of our days around the house quoting the movie ourselves.
That's true.
I love that violent hit right there.
We did that about 6 or 7 times to make that work.
God, that was a nasty hit, though. It was practical. It was real.
You're looking very alive.
Only on the outside.
This is not going to end well for me.
This is not going to end well for you, no. Where's your boss?
I can tell you exactly.
Oh, you'll tell me. But first, you might want to look away for this. Now, this little piggy went to... Thank you, Agent Smith.
Taxi!
Hop in. Waiting for a ride.
And we all know how this turned out.
Oh, here it comes.
Oh,
there it is.
I have that unicorn upstairs.
Yeah, that's
the third film you've masturbated in, Ryan?
It is the third feature-length film that I've masturbated
in. And what are the other two?
The Nines and Change Up are the two other films that I've... made love to myself in. I'm not proud to say.
That is an impressive filmography of
Thank you.
Masturbation.
Thank you very much. People have gotten a star on the Walk of Fame in Hollywood for less, my friend.
Seltzer water 11 for blood. Ooh. Some kinds of anger can't be managed. Like the kind we were here long.
I always look like, it always looks like that rag already has blood all over it.
I know. It does, doesn't it? Didn't even think about it when we were shooting it.
I'm just going to pick up my bloody rag and...
Yeah, the one I usually grab when yes. I lost an appendage.
I miss cocaine.
Oh.
In the script, Blind Al was introduced a little bit earlier than this in the fractured narrative.
16 walls. She's like Robin to my Batman, except she's old.
She was so much fun. Leslie Uggams is just such a trooper. She'll just... And this doesn't make her trooper, but it makes me adore her, which is that she'll just kind of... It's just game for anything. We just threw her that line like, God, I miss cocaine. And she just says it without even thinking about it.
Oh, she's great.
She was so wonderfully...
And a very talented actress.
And an incredible singer. One of the great singers.
Was in Roots, yes?
I'm not going to go there because I'm not 100% sure, but I know she sang with Frank Sinatra. She's done a...
She was on the Muppet Show. I know that.
I am.
Talk about the Crocs, Ryan. That was a Ryan...
Oh, yeah, the big rubber masturbating shoes. Yeah, the Crocs were sort of an addition that we liked. I don't know, just a, you know, character, adding as much yeah. kind of weird character with Deadpool as possible. I liked that he had his specific shoes that he liked to masturbate with. The IKEA is something that the boys here have had in the script for 6 years, which is, I love.
It's just weird, you know, it's... Yeah. But it's Deadpool weird, and that's why it works.
I just like that they have this whole language, this whole Swedish
yeah.
language there.
This was actually our first official day of shooting, though.
And, you know, it's interesting because the, you know, the traditional studio note would be, wait, he just lost his arm, his girl, and the bad guy, and he's talking about IKEA. It doesn't work. You've got to get them back on track. And, you know, again, Deadpool allows you to break all the rules, and we jumped at the chance.
Yeah.
I think the only rule with Deadpool is to break the rules.
True.
If that makes sense. Catching him was my only chance to be hot
again, get my super sexy ex back. And then we're back on point here. We're sort of saying what he's really, what's really going on.
That is lavender wasabi lotion.
Lavender wasabi lotion. My... unicorn wearing assless leather chaps, and the unicorn has a tiny penis, for the record.
Nevin Swain,
our incredible props guy. I would call Nevin in the middle of the night and say, Nevin, I need a tiny stuffed unicorn wearing assless chaps and a proportionate penis, and he would have that for me pretty much within 12 hours.
And he would say, is this for the movie or your personal needs?
And we would oftentimes, the line was blurred. Yeah, I can't even get an erection unless I have a unicorn in the room. I don't even care. Who knows that? Obviously, because I'm saying it in the commentary.
Oh, my.
Yeah.
Hey, Con. If there's nothing left of him too, he'll... You know, it's funny. Almost missed the fucker. I like a challenge. But he's bad for business. Now let's go find him.
Tylenol PM?
What I love about this scene is that there's a weirdly, like, sweet energy between Blind Al and Wade. And it, in a weird way, it just kind of lets us forgive how hostile they are toward each other half the time. You know?
Yeah, I mean, you know, it's... you love this woman and she loves you, and it's really, as abusive as the relationship is, it's... There's a real love behind it and a warmth.
Find this woman and tell her how you feel.
What do I keep telling you, Mrs. Magoo? She wouldn't have me.
You could see me. She's like the Oracle here, you know.
Looks are everything. You ever heard David Beckham speak? It's like he mouth sexed a can of helium.
Not many movies where the protagonist is played by an actor and references that same actor within the movie.
You're blind. So you're just going to lie there and whimper.
And in the comics, Ryan Reynolds is referenced in the comics.
He is, sure. Yeah.
In the meantime, you might want to leave the room. I bet it feels huge in this hand.
I say that line all the time.
So the doctor says the bad news is we don't have that long to live. So the patient says, how long do I have? The doctor says, 5.
This was a joke that TJ just
broke out on the day, and we thought it was nice because it dovetailed thematically.
Is it an original joke of his?
I think it's just one of those classic jokes that you just hear and it gets told and retold.
I can never tell a joke. Like, I can't retain them for some reason. I've never been able to be that guy who just.
My dad is a great, great joke teller. Really? One of the great joke tellers. Yeah, I don't have that. That's
a gift.
It is.
Well, TJ's got a bunch of them. He is a student of comedy.
He really is.
The history of comedy and stand-up and joke-telling, just everything. He's the guy.
We called him Benjamin Button on set because he would always button a scene with an improv joke.
Yeah.
He does it at the back end here.
He does about 50 of them at the back end here, but we had to eventually run out of digital.
Sweetheart, you might want to look around. This isn't really the place to do something like that.
Easy, Angel. Put the little man down. We have everything we need
now. Yeah, I mean, there's some funny people who turn it on for the camera and aren't funny in real life, and TJ's not one of those. He's funny in real life, too, and
very funny.
Woo! Thanks for having my back, guys. Wade, we have a fucking problem. And by we, I mean you.
Oh, I can't believe I'm doing this. Is there a word for half afraid, half angry?
Yeah, frangry, I guess. Have you decided what you're gonna say to her?
Fuck me.
Maybe not start with that.
Hey, coming onto our stage.
Stan Lee.
Give it up for Chastity.
Great Stan Lee cameo.
Or as I like to call it, irony.
There was a thought that we needed to make Stan Lee's dialogue as realistic as possible. So Paul got assigned the task of talking to the real strip club MC and writing down lines that he might really say and handing them to Stan Lee. And
really kind of the low point
that
of,
was
of
a, my probably the low point yeah, of
screenwriting
career.
Career when I'm sitting across from a guy and he's saying, show me them big old titties.
Oh, God.
Needless to say, Stan didn't say any of those lines.
He was game to do it, but there was a line that he drew in terms of exactly what he'd be willing to say.
Fortunately. Just Ryan's face right here. Just wow. It's just.
Yeah. Like, I mean, there are multiple times in the movie where I feel like that. When you first learn you have terminal cancer and you're looking at Vanessa, you could freeze frame that face and show it to anybody in the world and say, what's going on here? And they could tell you that this guy is in a horrible situation. And the same with this, the longing, you have a really wonderful ability to reveal an emotion on your face without doing much.
Talk about Ryan acting behind that. Because really, you're in a mask here as well. I mean, all that makeup, yeah. It's thick. There's glue. Well, you can't really move your face as naturally as you want. Talk about what that
is.
In
these instances, it's very helpful. I mean, you know, Bill Corso is so gifted at you know, applying prosthetic makeup isn't just, you know, throwing a mask on somebody and calling it a day. It's really like using the face that's already there and creating something else. And Bill gave me that ability to really kind of emote through that makeup. And, you know, I say that he sort of in a weird way did half my job for me. And that's true. I mean, I would leave that makeup trailer, you know, with really half the job done already. And I'm so grateful that he was on the movie. He was my first call when I knew we were going to do this movie. When we got the green light from the studio, I called Bill Corso to check if he was available. And thank God he was.
One of the few times it was actually not raining in Vancouver that we had to create rain.
I know.
I always wonder if the audience is at all genuinely surprised that it's Ajax and not you here.
I don't think so.
I don't think so either. I think they're ahead of us.
No.
It's our head to the back. Go get her, Tiger.
That was a sly wink to the Spider-Man line.
Mm-hmm.
And it comes back once more.
Yep.
And Bernadette Peters became the link. to indicate to Wade that Vanessa was grabbed from this alley in a violent fashion.
Motherfucker!
Wait.
Oh, I hit that thing hard. I remember that really, really fucking hurt my wrist.
Oh, man. Such an intense scene. Such a...
I gave Tim Miller two takes of this. I said, you get two takes, and then that's it.
I'm fine, then. I'm going to get angry. All right.
Here, this is Vanessa. What? Oh, no, wait, it's Francis. He wants you to come to him.
What is that?
This is a great little foreshadowing of the marketing campaign where they use those emojis on the billboards. I didn't realize that. Yeah.
That was all started as a text message, you know.
No, is that right?
Deadpool emoji, yeah.
Okay.
Our third movie we've had produced, Rhett and I, and our third arm up, grab the gun scene around the house.
Yeah. We like the arming up scene.
Yep. Oh.
It's got 3,000 rounds.
Hugh Jackman. I love that Hugh Jackman does appear in our movie in that regard, just because he's... I often think of Hugh Jackman as the guy that kind of ushered in the cool comic book character again, because when he created Wolverine and created that character and just so... I think it just so changed the game. It was a weird, it was a strange thing that it ushered in a whole new wave of comic book movies that were cool again. And
yeah, he's like our spiritual godfather.
Yeah, he really is. And such a sport, you know, was such a huge supporter of this movie and it getting made with the studio, because he's obviously one of the biggest stars the studio works with. And I definitely owe him a debt of gratitude.
Listen, Al, if I never see you again, I want you to know that I love you very much.
This was Ryan's idea, this cocaine bit.
There's about 116 kilos of cocaine buried somewhere in the apartment, right next to the cure for blindness. Good luck.
It's this seesawing between sentiment and emotion, and then undercutting that with just cynicism and cruelty.
Yeah, but there's a little truth there. I think Deadpool does really love her and wonders if he'll ever see her again, but he always has to kind of undercut it with the...
Want to get fucked up? The TV version that TJ.
Oh, yeah, what was it?
Want to get felt up.
Oh, yeah.
Which is worse.
So much worse, but totally fine for television.
Go on, then.
Thanks, Dickless. And I mean you.
You're a talker, too. You and Wade.
I've been trying to tell you, assholes, you've got the wrong girl. My old boyfriend, he's dead.
See, I thought that, too. But he keeps on coming back. Like a cockroach.
Or like a bad Jesus.
That was a line that Rhett and Paul had for as an alternate there. He keeps coming back like a bad Jesus, and I will always be sad that that's not actually in the movie. For whatever reason, it got C-blocked.
This mansion is in... Where is this mansion?
It's in Vancouver. Vancouver. In the Shaughnessy area of Vancouver.
From Alien 3.
Fuck, you're old.
Fake laugh. Hiding real pain. Go get silver balls.
You guys going for a bite? Early bird special?
Oh, like there's something wrong with eating before sundown or saving money. No, you know that bad guy that you let go?
That's real for me, by the way.
Me too.
Yeah.
You're going to help me get her back.
Wade, is that you?
Yeah, it's me, Deadpool, and I got an offer that you can't refuse. I'm going to wait out here, okay? It's a big house. It's funny that I only ever see two of you. It's almost like the studio couldn't afford another X-Men.
Ladies and gentlemen, Ryan Reynolds, the genius of Ryan Reynolds right there. Biggest laugh of the movie.
That one I love. It was just funny because it's true.
It is just about the biggest laugh of the movie. Yeah, it's.
I sat behind Jim Giannopoulos, who's the head of Fox, when that joke played, and he was howling, laughing so hard.
He's also laughing because it's true.
True, yeah.
Colossus is written on that Starbucks cup. Unfortunately, you can't quite get enough of a glimpse of it, but I just love the idea of him going into the Starbucks barista. Right. What's your name, Colossus?
That's your scream, Ryan, yes?
Yes, that is my
scream. You play Bondu.
I guess I do technically play Bondu.
Are you listening to the credits? Are you listening to the credits as Bondu?
No, I have no idea.
You should be.
Yeah. I do a couple of screams and yells for other people, too.
Really?
Yeah.
He's tied up in the trunk. I'm doing, as you said, DP. I plan to gut him like a tandoori fish, then dump his carcass on Geeta's doorstep.
I did not tell him to do that. Absolutely not. He got lost in translation. Dopinder, this is no way to win Geeta's heart back.
I'm so proud of you.
Drop Bandu off, safe and gentle-like.
Kill him.
And then...
This is a very big crowd pleaser to this little bit right here, right?
Oh, I love it. Also funny because it's true.
Oh! I presume a crisp high five.
For you? 10. Okay, guys, let's get out there and make a difference.
You know what to do.
Welcome, Deadpool boy!
We intended to have DMX, X-Go and Give It To You in there from the very earliest draft of the script. We just love that song, and thankfully it made it all the way through.
And it's become the anthem of the movie in a way.
It really has.
Yeah, they used it in marketing.
Every commercial, and it's... Tim, and Chimichanga, that's our Chimichanga reference there. We had to have that in the film.
Yeah. And this third act action... Tim Miller did such a wonderful job of balancing budget versus action and giving us scope and scale with not a lot of money in this sequence. I mean, particularly this massive fight between Colossus and Angel Dust.
Leave a message and have a happy day.
God damn it! I'm gonna do this the old-fashioned way. Two swords and maximum effort.
Maximum effort was a catchphrase. Was that a comic catchphrase or did you come up with that, Ryan?
I thought you guys came up with that. I don't know. I love it, but yeah, I always thought it was you.
I can't remember exactly, but he uses it now 3 times in the movie, I think.
I love it.
What's my name?
Ooh, I'm going to fucking spell it out for you.
At one point, we had...
She's going to do a superhero landing. Wait for it.
Stripes. Francis.
Yeah.
I don't know if you guys remember...
On the television.
Yep.
In the bar. I wish it was still there. But.
Totally impractical. They all do it. You're a lovely lady, but I'm saving myself for Francis. That's why I brought him.
I prefer not to hit a woman, so please, please.
I mean, that's why I brought her? Oh, no, finish your tweet. It's not. That's fine. Just give us a second. There you go. Hashtag it.
Brianna's first feature film role, correct?
I think so, that's yeah. True. Yeah, she was a hell of a find. And just such a great look to her as well. With the, love her hair. I love everything about her. She's such a nice girl, too.
The X-Men unitard, when's the last time we saw that in a movie? Is it
never.
Ever?
That, never. Nobody's ever put it in as it is in the comics until now. And I'm very proud of that. And, you know, we got to thank Tim for that as well. Tim really was a huge supporter of, you know, canon and always kind of staying faithful to the comics. And one of the things was the X suit that she's wearing. And the other big get was both Colossus and, of course, Deadpool. You know, his suit being so faithful to the comics as well.
This is Gina, actually, I think, doing the fighting.
Oh, yeah.
As you know, she's MMA and a pretty bad ass, so.
God, that would hurt so much to
really
do that.
Oh.
Just every time it makes me cringe.
Wait!
You can't see. There's a tiny shit streak on that underwear that they didn't, that they never really captured on film. But
that was a real shit streak, was it not?
Yeah. Tidy whities.
Possibly even lover-like treatment. Fine, Commando.
This is one of my favorite pieces of action. So nasty, but so fun.
Your stunt double, Alex, tore his ACL in this scene.
Oh, it just exploded in this scene, and I felt so horrible because blew his knee out so I wouldn't blow mine out is how I looked at it. And but thankfully it has a happy ending. His knee is now stronger and better than ever. He got a great doctor and
was back shooting.
Back shooting our reshoots. You know, he was already back doing stunts for that. It's actually right here. That's where he blew his knee out. And that lead, it looks like nothing, but yeah.
Such a great guy.
Yeah. Big, huge Deadpool fan from the Ukraine, and he's been a Deadpool fan for 15 years or so. He's...
That is not Gina, actually.
And one would hope not.
Nor is that.
Teabag! Bob?
We? This always felt very Deadpool to us, that we could stop right in the middle of a massive action scene and have a very personal connection moment here. As ridiculous as it is.
How are the kids?
Good? And Gail, she's still fixing that tuna casserole?
So good.
Oh, but bad for the waistline, if you know what I'm talking about.
You're on the left. You're beautiful.
That is so sweet. Thanks.
You know, when you're building a cast, you do try to anticipate the interaction between characters. And one of the reasons we chose Colossus is because he is a goody two shoes. He is a bit of a prude. Mm-hmm. There's the name and the name and bodies, which was
one guy with his pants down. That's overlooked a lot.
but you know, because Colossus is such a straight arrow, it makes him all the more fun opposite Deadpool, who is a lunatic.
He becomes a little bit of Spider-Man here.
It's a little Spider-Man. That jump was a little... I pushed it a little bit.
I love the girlish screams.
Yeah, totally. Yeah.
It's just not enough for him to scream. He's
Deadpool's
scream
not
like
a manly man.
Girl.
He is part 10-year-old girl.
That was filmed on a... what do they call that?
A gimbal.
A gimbal.
Yeah, that's it. Giant sort of floating platform that rotates and rocks via remote control.
Yeah, and then ultimately tilts, which gave us our, you know, careening flight deck look.
We cut that out, but this guy grabs my leg on the ground and I say, your plan to trip me to death has failed. And then I break his neck or crush him.
Red really is my color.
Wait.
Don't worry, baby. Let me get you out of that shit box.
What better way to crawl back inside that head of yours?
Oh, you never left.
But you did, asshole!
Deep breath, darling. No way. Wrong choice of words.
I hope they've locked pain to your every last nerve, because I'm gonna go look it!
You grow back body parts now, Wade. When I'm finished, parts will have to grow back you.
Good one.
Yep, that was a good one. Let's dance.
I think that was like an impromptu fourth wall break. I don't know if that was ever meant to be a fourth wall break until we...
It makes me laugh. I say, and again, another one I say around the house.
Yeah, it's a good one.
We call Ryan the elevator because he elevates every single thing he's in.
Now you're just being sweet to me. Come on.
I'm serious. It's, you don't...
We worked. I'll say that us three work together very, very, very well, and I hope we get to work together till we're all very, very old and grayer. Both Rhett and I are already getting gray, whereas Paul is.
Come on, I'm just gray as can be.
Die, John.
Totally, 100%.
The music that's about to kick in here was. Originally John Denver.
It sure was, wasn't it?
Rhett was a John Denver massive song. John Denver fan, or is a massive John Denver fan.
Of course, still am.
It's one of the few times, though, we've had to change music for the film that I thought we actually improved on.
When Chicago took its place, I'm also a huge Chicago fan, so it felt like a lateral move to me.
Rhett's an easy listener.
It's hard to pick the music for Deadpool because it has to be ironic, but it still has to be good. and emotional, and it's so you're not really picking songs that, you know, are sort of one-hit wonder sucky songs. You're picking songs that are slightly legendary but also slightly ironic, so it's like got a weird tone.
Yeah,
it's always tough picking the songs.
Yeah, but also easy to pick the songs in a way too, because it's so freeing. You can think of any genre. True. If it works.
But
for
when
the
you
moment.
Hear one that works, you know it works right away. Whereas
that's true.
We always knew right away if something wouldn't work.
Tim had this idea of putting these animated cartoon
yeah.
characters, and really bizarre and fucked up, but awesome at the same time.
Yeah,
in this particular scene. Again, here's our love story, and then undercut with.
Oh, I always enjoy that moment. This is a great example of sound mixing you're going to see here, where they just pump this song up right when we need it. You'll hear it just kind of pop.
You know, just a little visual effect of the blood popping out there. Tim is such a VFX maestro, you know, he owns a VFX company here in Los Angeles, and it's just really how he got his start, and it's just brilliant at it, and you know, you can see it in this entire third act.
Weirdly, that you can't do that little thing in a PG-13 movie. That's just one of the billion things that we were able to do with this movie as a rated R film that we couldn't have done otherwise.
Yeah, we really do owe thanks to Jim Giannopoulos and Stacey Snyder and Emma Watts for allowing us to do this R. There's obviously a glass ceiling on box office grosses. You make a lot less with an R-rated movie than you do with a PG-13 movie. And they were willing to sacrifice those hard dollars for this crazy creative experience. And we should really thank them for that.
Yeah. And we also, you know, I personally throw them under the bus all the time as a joke in the media when we're talking about Deadpool. But the real story is that they were 100% supportive of this film being an R-rated film, and 100% supportive of sacrificing, like you said, that huge amount of money to deliver an authentic Deadpool that the fans deserve. So.
You know, that this movie is many things, and it's an apple amongst oranges. You know, there's an oversaturation of superhero movies out there, and this is unlike all of them because it is R and it does break all the rules.
We were lucky though, you know, this movie could have been made 6 years ago, and I don't know that it would be as effective just given the fact that we're in a climate of just extraordinary saturation in superhero movies, and we're at that intersection where it's kind of, you know, we're ready for something a little bit different. Big styrofoam stone. That torture device has a 5-star safety rating, as you can see. Her surviving that fall.
Yeah, that would never protect someone in real life. But this is the movies.
Yes, it is. I did not perform this stunt, I would like everyone to know.
Oh.
But Adrian did, one of my stunt doubles. Ably. I did this, though. I do enjoy punching.
Snap. And snap.
Oh, yeah.
There are no words. Me and you are headed to fix this butterface.
What? Not as uncomfortable as it looks. This is an entirely foam set. You can practically jump up and down on it like a bed.
Yeah, it was sort of fun in a weird way. It was like one of those gyms that's like for kids where you get to just run around and jump on anything.
So, you mean to say, after all this,
You can't fix me?
I love the Colossus has a speech coming up about four or five moments that define a hero, and this is something that Rhett and Paul wrote that it's one of the great things about this, I think, about this sequence, which is that it really resonates. It's actually could work very well in any kind of superhero movie and stand on its own as a dramatic and beautiful moving speech, which of course we undercut with extraordinary violence.
Yeah, and we worked on the timing quite a bit. We didn't want the audience to get ahead of the gunshot and expect it coming, but we kind of wanted them to get ahead of it just a touch, so they were wincing, bit, yeah. Going, you don't think he's about to possibly...
And seeing it with an audience, they do, you can see them anticipating the shot and still waiting for it and wanting it.
They start tittering, yeah. You know, about, yeah.
It really matter. Moments when you're offered a choice to make a sacrifice, conquer a flaw, save a friend, spare an enemy.
Right about here, they start to figure it out.
Everything else falls away.
What Colossus is what about? What was it? $50,000 a sec? What was this?
It was something crazy. I was like, so much of our budget went to creating Colossus, but worth every penny.
Every penny.
Maybe stuck looking like pepperoni flatbread, but at least fuckface won't heal from that. It's wearing superhero tights. I mean, sparing psychopaths, and maybe I wasn't meant to wear them. Not everyone monitors a hall like you.
Just promise.
Yeah, yeah, I'll be on the lookout for the next 4 moments. Shit. Now, if you'll excuse me, I'm just a boy.
What movie is that from? What movie are we referencing?
Is that Notting Hill?
It's
maybe Notting Hill.
I think it's Notting Hill.
Hill or the other one, other British
Julia
one.
Roberts, I thought. I'm just a girl.
I think it is Notting Hill.
In front of a boy.
Start talking!
I'm sorry. I'm so sorry. For everything. I'm sorry for leaving. I'm sorry for not cowboying up sooner. A couple of years.
I just love this scene so much. It's just Ryan. You can hear it so just great. Act the fuck out of this scene right here.
Every
just,
now and then, you can catch the dated references. The cowboying up was in reference to the Boston Red Sox cowboying up against the Yankees.
I didn't know that, really.
Yeah, many years ago, and you just go, oh yeah, we really did write this script a long time ago.
But again, we're back to the beating heart of the movie. You know, the love story, the love story between these two broken souls. You know.
I do like this sequence.
And
I'm not sure everybody understood that it was kind of a callback to their first meeting, but
it seems like they catch on. Yeah, they catch on as the scene goes, but the big for a little bit there, they don't quite get what's going on.
I should have come and found you sooner. But maybe the guy under this mask, he ain't the same one that you remember.
You mean this mask?
Yeah, and we always thought that the Hugh Jackman mask under the other mask would, once again, undercut emotion with comedy, and hopefully, you know.
That was a fun phone call to Hugh. Here's what we're thinking.
Here's what we had in mind.
How do you feel about me stapling your face to my face?
And a little bit of a cheat here, because that was supposed to be, if you do the math right, that was supposed to be cut out from the People magazine.
Yeah.
But it's too big.
Sexiest
it's
man, too but big. It's too yeah. big, obviously.
It's to fit my giant head is what you're really trying to say. My head is huge. Like an orange on a toothpick, to quote Mike Myers.
Wow.
Marina did a great job here, because she has to take the character from very skeptical and cynical back to full-on commitment in about 2 minutes, and she did a nice job of it.
It's a face I'd be happy to sit on, ladies and gentlemen, Rhett Reese.
Yeah.
When I read that, when Rhett wrote that, I read it, I'm like, they're never making this movie.
It hung in there for 6 years. It never got taken out.
Never changed. No. That's probably why the movie wasn't made for 6 years.
That line.
Super penis.
Come on, Wade. Language. Young one is present.
What are you?
What are you still doing? Get out of here. Go make yourself useful. You, go be a really big brother to someone. Tell Beast to stop shitting on my lawn, and you.
The Beast shitting on my lawn was going to be a coda that we
had. Paul wrote the funniest coda ever where the Beast, is Deadpool literally catches Beast shitting on his lawn.
Let people know what a coda is first.
Yes, that's the scene at the very end, after the credits. And Paul just had this zany idea of what if we actually catch Beast shitting on Deadpool's lawn and running off and Deadpool chasing him, you know, angrily holding his morning newspaper. And
Nicholas Holt was game. He was game. He loved it.
We just couldn't make the schedule work.
Yeah.
For the moment I've all been waiting for.
Poor Moraine head. Not looking my best right there.
Again, a plant that we then paid off here.
Another song that really stayed in this script from the beginning, I think, right?
Yeah.
That was, yeah. Thank you, George Michael, for letting us use.
And Ridgely, don't forget about Ridgely.
And Ridgely, of course. Wow. That was like 24 walls right there. Me singing.
Oh my gosh.
While the movie was singing while George Michael was singing. I love that little sequence. I want to shoot,
baby, shoot. Salt and Pepper.
Ooh. That was another song that we had in the movie initially in every place that Shoop is in, and it was just too damn expensive, so he ended up with Shoop. But in a weird way, Shoop was better. It worked so much better, and sort of worked with the tone of the movie in a great way. Here's where you'll get to see if I was Bandu or not in the credits. I don't think I was, though. Nope.
Hmm.
Oh, well.
So Bandu is not even listed.
I'm uncredited. Yep.
Get me Ryan's agent on line two, please.
You have two lines?
I do.
Wow.
The first line doesn't work, though.
Yeah.
Here in Ryan's house, you have two lines? This is getting weird.
That's super weird.
I've been living in the crawl space for the last little bit here.
Oh, Joan Bierman, our post supervisor. There's so many people that work on these movies that are never front and center, but just they work so goddamn hard. And Joan is one of them. Joan just day in and day out just gave this movie her last drop of blood in post. And it was an accelerated post on this film because Fox gave us very little time between shooting and our release date to get this movie completely finished and ready for its audience. And a key component to that success was Joan Bierman.
We started shooting in March of 2000.
Not true, April. Because we'd already, remember we shot the April Fool's gag with Mario Lopez and then started shooting, which was...
Is that right? Yeah, you're right.
It was like April 4, I think we started shooting, yeah.
Wow.
And, you know, came out in February, is coming out in February. So that's, a 10-month turnaround?
Yeah.
And with all the visual effects and just amazing. Just a
really tough deadline to meet. But what's great expression that the task expands for the time allotted or something like that?
Yeah, exactly.
It seems to be about right for this. Yeah.
And we're actually 9 days away from the movie actually releasing.
As we record this, we're 9 days out.
So we have no idea whether this has a happy ending.
Yeah,
I mean, we know whether this session's going to happen.
Absolutely.
What?
Absolutely.
You know,
I think hands, one for each of you.
I'll bet it feels huge in this hand.
There's a general misconception that, well, I don't know how much of a misconception it is, that everybody in Hollywood's out just lying on the beach and we're all doing cocaine. And maybe those things happen now and again, but what's really happening is everybody is working their butt off. Like when you watch a movie like this and you watch these names, you know, just drift past, these are people who worked, you know, 18, 19 hour days often back to back to back to back to bring this to life. So it's just, I'm just going to stand up for the people of Hollywood and remind everybody how hard they work to make this magic, you know, happen.
Absolutely. In a lot of different cities too, not just Los Angeles, but all over the country and all over the world, frankly.
Yeah. Vancouver.
Yeah.
And our VFX was done all over the place. It's just, you know, when you're a citizen And these movies come out in theaters, you think they just come out, and you don't realize the many, many years of labor. Yeah.
And all those people put their blood, sweat, and tears into the ones that work, and they put the same blood, the same sweat, the same tears in the ones that don't work.
Like this one. I'm kidding.
Wow.
No, this one is awesome. We love it.
We do love it. I quite literally miss shooting this film. And a special thanks with tongue to Rob Liefeld and Fabian.
Did they break the two codas here, or is it one long coda at the end? I don't know how we ended up on that.
It's one long one.
Is it?
Yep. Yeah, this full coda was never shown to the fan screenings or test audience. Yeah.
Whose idea was the Ferris Bueller thing?
I don't remember. We're still here. I thought it was one of you guys.
Yeah, I think that was me.
Yeah, I think that was you, wasn't it? I couldn't remember.
Expecting a teaser for Deadpool 2. Well, we don't have that kind of money. We expecting Sam Jackson show up with an eye patch and a...
They made us change the wallpaper, Paramount Pictures.
Because it was too damn close to the... Oh, maybe it is broken up. Because it was too damn close to the original Ferris Bueller wallpaper.
So I think Tim put in some penises onto the wallpaper.
Yes,
if you look closely.
There are penises on the wallpaper.
I'm not kidding.
There? No, there are. Cast yet,
but it could be anybody. I don't see any. Guy with a flat top.
Could be Mel Gibson. You wouldn't.
He's got range. Who knows? Anyway, big secret. Shh. Oh, and don't leave your garbage all lying around. It's a total.
That was a nod to Tim Miller, who hates people who leave their garbage at movie theaters. I am among them.